Hi friends, this is Nipunika Shahid and the subject expert for today's topic is Dr. Manu Sharma. She has been working as an assistant professor with Amity School of Communication. I welcome you all to another interesting session on editing. During this session, we learn about the objectives of copy editing, strategies involved in attaining a perfect copy, and some basics associated with copy editing and proofreading symbols. To start with, let's talk about the idea behind editing. All of us would agree to this that a newspaper is published so as to inform, interpret, serve, and entertain people. But what if the plethora of information published inside a newspaper fails to accomplish its objective? So at the end of the day, a newspaper, or for that matter, any printed material gains its real value if the information in it is presented intelligently. And for an intelligent presentation, editing is a must. In the field of mass communication, editing can be executed for print, magazines, newspapers, etc., as well as electronic, audio-visual mediums, media messages. In this session, we'll restrict our discussion to copy editing, which is meant for print media, majorly comprising of magazines, newspapers, and advertisement copies. In copy editing, copy refers to written or typewritten text for typesetting, printing, or publication. And the task of copy editing is done before both typesetting and proofreading, the latter of which is the last step in the editorial cycle. Copy editing is something much more than the routine proofreading, as proofreading is only concerned with the fact that whether the type agrees with the copy or not. On the other hand, copy editing involves the usage of proof marks as editing devices. It includes the corrections in text, which further polishes the content, checks it in terms of accuracy and completion, ensures that it is clear, condensed, properly arranged, verifies the legal aspects associated with it, and if it matches the style rules being followed by the publication, and thus, at the end, makes certain that the content would contribute in better understanding of the information. Copy editing is not only about having the knowledge of important editing tools, but also the knowledge of how and when to use them. Unlike general editing, copy editing might not involve changing the substance of the text, and it won't be wrong to say that it's about loving the colons and semicolons. And trust me, an edited copy can act as glue that can actually cement relations between some warring groups within the newsroom. So, whatever may be the source, any and every story that is destined to be published requires copy editing, and for the same, it comes to the desk of a copy editor, who is basically a person who does this work. As far as the profile and skill set of a copy editor is concerned, besides an excellent command of language, copy editors need broad general knowledge for spotting factual errors, good critical thinking skills in order to recognize inconsistencies or vagueness, interpersonal skills for dealing with writers, other editors and designers, attention to detail, and a sense of style. Also, they must establish priorities and balance a desire for perfection with the necessity to follow deadlines. Many copy editors have a college degree, often in journalism, the language the text is written in, or communications. So, from such a descriptive account of a copy editor's profile, it can be concluded that a copy editor does not do the following activities, namely, rewriting and restructuring text in depth, often known as developmental or substantive editing, ghostwriting, proofreading which has a different purpose, text or cover design, indexing, research beyond basic fact-checking, and seeking permission to use copyright material. These examples somewhere indicate that no doubt editing is about good decision-making, but it also means that one should know when to stop editing. On one hand, it's definitely about following rules of editing, but on the other hand, one should also know about breaking them when they don't seem to help or fall out of date. Copy editing is all about making strategic choices such that the choice should attain a balance between perfection and pragmatism. It is a blend of skill and common sense. Editing is about a belief that fairness and balance serve everyone's interest best. Strategy in terms of editing simply means identifying the goals of the line editing job and planning how to achieve them in the time available. It is a skill acquired by experience and self-discipline. With experience comes the following realizations in context of strategies in copy editing. 1. Some manuscripts would be read mainly for hard data, and so they require most attention to the fact that they must be beautiful, while others require purely an editorial based emphasis. A copy editor must know when to apply what. 2. Some scripts badly need the revision, and so the author or reporter must be called to prepare another draft. At times, editor attempts to elaborate and revise the script page by page. As a result, the job gets out of hand and it's too late to go back or forward. 3. Script should be broken up into smaller elements, usually a three-part series, and such breaking requires strategic planning. 4. Some manuscripts are beyond an editor's technical knowledge. In such a situation, a care approach is needed to tackle the problem. 5. There are different levels and depths for each script, and that content must be edited, taking into consideration the appropriate depth, and the standard should be maintained throughout the script. 6. The level of editing should be decided by taking into account the perception of author, such that the editor should never try to superimpose their own insights upon the author's imperfectly completed thoughts. One, every member of the staff should develop a critical curiosity about all kinds of news with which he has to deal. One should test every statement in terms of its accuracy. 2. Every member of the staff should realize the kind of people for whom the paper is intended. The public that buys is intelligent, discriminating, and well-informed. So the staff members should also possess these qualities. 3. Don't pass the statements that you don't understand. This is so because if it's not clear to the editor, how will it be clear to the ordinary reader? 4. Reporters usually include in an article details which do not interest them in the least. Putting them in sentence and paragraph form has no magic virtue in making them readable. If they are not interested in what they write, why should they expect the reader to be interested in it? They must buttonhole the reader and seize their interest. 5. By now, we know about the basics of copy editing. Another important concept in copy editing is that of a style sheet. A style sheet is a document that the copy editor prepares which further lists the grammatical conventions, characters, places, unusual or made-up words, and the distinctive treatment of words, capitalization, hyphenation, favored spellings, etc. within a particular text. In copy editing, style sheets are useful in numerous ways. They help the copy editor maintain consistency. For fantasy and science fiction based content, style sheets are particularly important for a number of reasons. SF or F books often come in series, and a thorough style sheet is important for maintaining continuity from one book to the next. Since these books generally contain a large number of made-up places and terms, so it can be difficult to remember the exact spelling of the name of a minor character unless you've already written it down and can refer back to your list. Style sheets are always provided to the proofreader, and since a style sheet is created with the purpose of filling in the gaps that are left by the broad, sweeping rules of a chosen style guide, so there is a certain amount of flexibility that one can have in their construction. Rather than following a rigid series of rules in their making and use, they are created in a manner that they serve the needs of copy editor and proofreader. A copy editor may allow a series of spelling errors to be kept in a manuscript if he feels it contributes to the author's narrative styling. So, viewers, the essence of any style sheet must be to demonstrate changes, explain them, as well as to explain exceptions to standard style guidelines. Commonly, a style sheet is created by clearly labeling the name of the work, the author, publisher, and all pertinent data centered at the top of the page. Remember, this will be passed from one desk to another. So, it's imperative that people always know what it's for. This will reduce the chances of someone having a brain fart and throwing it out. Then, running down the left margin of the page, place every letter of the alphabet in sequence. If on paper, be sure to give yourself half dozen spaces between letters. At times, people confuse these two distinct editorial skills, but it's important to recognize how different they are and on what basis do they differ. The most obvious distinction is the form the medium takes. Copy editing, once performed by making marks and writing revisions on a typewritten manuscript, is now generally carried out by entering changes in a word processing program like Microsoft Word. Proofreading, by contrast, is done on a facsimile of the finished product, a proof, hence the name. Proofreading is usually still completed on hard copy with a pen or pencil, but it's sometimes accomplished by electronically marking up a PDF. A file created with Adobe's portable document format. That's where the initials come from. The copy editor's task is to finesse a writer's prose so that it observes all the conventions of good writing. A writer may be skilled at explaining a procedure or verbally depicting a scene, but the copy editor is the one who makes sure the manuscript's syntax is smooth, that the writing adheres to the conventions of grammar, and that wording is proper and precise, and punctuation is appropriate and correctly placed. The copy editor may also do or suggest some reorganizing, recommend changes to chapter titles and subheadings, and call out lapses in logic or sequential slip-ups. All the while, if the project is a book manuscript, an extensive report, or something else of significant length, the copy editor compiles a style sheet, a statement of overall editorial policy. Serial comma or no question mark, numbers spelled out or in numeral form, and a record of idiosyncratic word usage. The proofreader, by contrast, is assigned to check a reproduction of what the finished product will look like. And the task is not revision, but correction, making sure that no typographical errors remain from the manuscript or were introduced in the production stage. The proofreader is also the main beneficiary of the style sheets compilation. Proofreaders are also expected to check page numbers or recurring copy at the top or bottom of a page that identifies a section in a periodical or a chapter or book title. They make sure the font and type size and weight for one text element matches another element of that class. They double check that photo captions match the content of the photographers, or that when text refers to a table, a chart or a figure, the graphic element consists of what the text says it does, and they proof that element too. Proofreaders may also catch grammatical errors or inconsistency of style, and they are often given some leeway to change or at least call out egregious errors. But they are generally constrained by not being permitted to revise the text in any way that adds or subtracts the number of lines on a page, because doing so may adversely affect the graphic design. Copy editing is a more qualitative skill, and proofreading is more quantitative by nature. Delete. Remove it from take it out. Close up. Print as one word. Delete and close up. Remove O from close up. Caret. Insert here. Insert a space. Put one space here. Space evenly. Space evenly where indicated. Let stand. Let marked stand as set. Transpose. Change the order. Used to separate two or more marks, and often as a concluding stroke at the end of an insertion. Set farther to the left. Too far to the right. Set farther to the right. Too far to the left. Set as ligature, such as encyclopedia. Align horizontally. Alignment. Align vertically. Align with surrounding text. Broken character. Imperfect. Indent or insert M quad space. Begin a new paragraph. Spell out. Set 5 lbs as 5 pounds. Set in capitals. Set NATO as NATO. Set in small capitals. Set signal as SIGNAL. Set in lowercase. Set south as SOUTH. Set in italic. Set over as OEUVRE. Set in Roman. Set MENCH as MENSCH. Set in boldface. Set important as important. Hyphen multicolored. N dash 1965 to 72. M or long dash. Now, at last, we know. Superscript or superior, as in pi r square. Subscript or inferior, as in H2O. Centered, for a centered dot in PQ. Comma, apostrophe, period, semicolon, colon. Quotation marks, parentheses, brackets. Query to author, has this been set as intended? Push down a workup, an unintended mark. Turn over an inverted letter, inverted, R is inverted. Wrong font. Wrong size or style. Appear. Comments were made. A horizontal line delete mark is made through a phrase, sentence or paragraph. A vertical line delete mark is made through a single letter or mark of punctuation. The letter or punctuation to be deleted may also be circled with the delete mark. A stroke through a capital letter means set it in lowercase. Three lines under a lowercase letter mean to make it a capital. One line under a word means to set in italics. A series of strike-throughs means to remove underlining. A wavy line means to set in boldface. This mark means to close up space. It's often used with the delete mark. This mark means begin a new paragraph. A straight line between letters or characters means to add one space. A space mark means the same thing. Two short parallel lines mean insert a hyphen. This mark means to change the order of or transpose letters, words or phrases. Dots under a word or passage mean leave the word or passage as it was before the correction. The word stet, let it stand, is often written in the margin. Last but not the least, here are some of the common newspaper terms that one must know in addition to the editing and proofreading symbols discussed. 1. ABC, Audit Bureau of Circulations. 2. AD, Advertisement. 3. ADD, Additional News Material to be appended to the story. 4. Advance, a story concerning a future event. 5. Agate, type measuring 5.5 points in depth. Newspaper columns and advertisements are measured in agate lines. 6. Art, newspaper illustrations. 7. Assignment, a reporter's designated task. 8. Bank, lower section of headline, a table on which set type is placed. 9. Banner or banner line, a page wide head in larger type. 10th, beat, a reporter's regular territory for news coverage, a story published solely by one newspaper. 11th, bende, term referring to mechanical process for shading line engravings. 12th, BF, bold or dark face type. 13th, binder line, one line of large type on an inside page over an especially lengthy story or a number of stories on one general topic. 14th, body type, type in which the major part of the newspaper is set. 15th, boilerplate, syndicate materials in metal plate form. 16th, box, type bordered by rules. 17th, break, the point at which a story goes from one page or one column to another. A story breaks when it is available for publications. 18th, bulldog, early edition of a morning paper. 19th, bulletin, significant last minute news. 20th, bureau, news gathering body organized in a center of importance. 21st, byline, signature above a story. 22. Canned copy, material received from publicity offices or press agents. 23rd, caps, contraction for capitals. 24. Caption, explanation of a photograph, illustration or a diagram. 25th, case, cabinet to type where printer works. 26. CGO, can go over, that is the story is such that it can be printed at any time or any place. 27. chaise. Metal frame used for holding in page form, type and cuts ready for printing. 28. Circus makeup. Usage of several headlines of different sizes and type kinds to create a bizarre effect. 29. Composing room. Department where type is set. 30. Copy holder. Newsroom employee who reads aloud to proofreader from manuscript. 31. Cross line. Portion of a headline differentiated from the top and banks. 32. Crusade. A newspaper campaign for reform or improvement. 33. Cub. An unseasoned reporter. 34. Cut. A newspaper engraving to shorten a story. 35th. Cut off. A rule across a column or columns to separate one part of the page from the rest of it. 36th. Dateline. Place of origin and date put at the beginning of non-local news. 37th. Deck. Part of headline. 38th. Delete. Remove the sentence or line. 39th. EM. Measure of type width. 40. Flag. Newspaper title appearing on the first page. 41. FYI. For your information. 42. Jump. Carrying of a story from one page to another. 43. Must. Instruction on a copy that it must be published without fail. 44. Play up. To display a story prominently. 45th. Release. An instruction to print a story set earlier and held for later disposition. 46th. Slug. Notation on the copy to identify the story, a guideline in type. 47th. Sob stuff. Stories that are sentimental and designed to appeal to the sympathy of the reader. 48. Stet. Let it stand. 49. 30. The end. 50. Time copy. Copy held for later use after it has been set. 51. Typo. Typographical mistake. So, from such a detailed discussion on copy editing, it can be concluded that copy editing is everywhere where the words are being written and published, and though almost everyone feels that she or he can be an editor, it's not that simple a task. It's a job which requires one to have a technical know-how of the subject in addition to literary skills. It involves working upon and putting in efforts on someone else's words so as to make them literate and clear. I hope you've enjoyed the session, and next time you sit on editing desk, hope you'll remember the prerequisites of the editing task. In addition to whatever has been talked about, it also includes selflessness and respect for anonymity at times. We'll meet again with some valuable inputs on another interesting topic from the domain of mass communication. Till then, goodbye and happy learning.